We appreciate your being with us. I think we're in for a really interesting night. You've got our esteemed guests' bios on your table, so I'm not going to go over them. But on this issue of refugees and immigration, executive orders, it would, I think, be hard for us to assemble two more esteemed, knowledgeable, experienced people on this. So we are thrilled to do this tonight. We, as folks in the community know, we've done a series of talks on things this semester, from the environment to immigration. So this is another in the series, and we'll keep them going as long as you all keep coming. So I'm gonna sort of serve as the moderator. We'll go for maybe 45 minutes or so, and then we'll open it up for questions. But I want to sort of first, so this is Jonathan Polonsky on my far left, and Chuck, you go by Chuck Cook.
Chuck looks Cook. Weird when you write it, when you say it, when you write it down, it looks weird. It's like Chuck Cook.
Chuck Cook. Yeah. CK.
It's an immigrant name. What do you want? You know?
Yeah, from the middle. So let me ask you both, and I'll start with you, Jonathan, if you just...
Actually, John is fine.
John is fine, okay. So we got JP and CK here. John is a corporate attorney. He doesn't do this for a living. But if you
although a litigator, commercial litigator.
Okay, so if you'd share a little bit about how you have ended up in this world of immigration law.
Okay, our firm, by the way, has a long history of community service and community activity, and in fact, we have a 30-hour-a-year requirement for partners of pro bono, and if you haven't done your 30 hours at the end of the year, you have to explain why not to the compensation committee. And unless you have worked an ungodly number of hours, it's hard to explain why you couldn't come up with that. In looking for a pro bono area, I was interested in working with children, but without the background in family law, wasn't ready to go into family court, domestic violence, and such. Our firm has a relationship with a group called Kids in Need of Defense, which works with undocumented, unaccompanied minors who come to the U.S. usually to reunite with a family member, and works with them to get a special kind of visa for them, and the details are way too long for tonight, but it's called an SIJ visa. And Kind came and spoke to us, and their presentation spoke to me, and I ended up taking on the case of two sisters, one 14, one 17, who had been living in Nicaragua with their grandmother, supported by their mother, who was living in Brooklyn and is also undocumented. When the grandmother died, they had no one to live with, and it certainly wasn't safe for the two of them to stay there. So the mother arranged to bring them up to the U.S. to live with them. Unfortunately, as they got off the first bus just over the border in Texas, apparently ICE, the immigration police had been tipped off and snatched them up. They were detained in a center in Texas and then moved up to Brooklyn where their mother is. And to my surprise, at that time, you could parole detainees out in your care, even though you yourself was undocumented. These days, that is probably an unsafe thing to do, to go down to an immigration detention center and make yourself known. And so I picked up their case. I worked with one of my associates, and as, at least in my experience, all things immigration, after a year and a half, we finally got them the SIJ visa.
Only a year and a half? Yeah. Only a year and a half, that's actually.
I think Manhattan works a lot quicker than Atlanta, and has more reasonable judges.
That is a way to phrase it, yes.
Yeah, I was trying to come up with a nice word.
It's an appropriate word.
And now that they have the SIJ visa, they're eligible to get green cards in in a year. They've both been going to high school in the meantime in Brooklyn. One of them hopes to be a teacher. The other one used to want to be a doctor, now wants to be a lawyer, but I'm not
holding my breath. You can probably cure her of that still.
No. She wants to be a lawyer since she met me. But I again...
Have her call me. I'll talk her out of it.
If she's serious, I'll talk her out of it. Or I'll send her to CUNY, to the University of New York, where... Since she lives in New York, she will at least get very inexpensive tuition, unlike the rest of law school.
Yeah.
Chuck, you want?
Well, I'm an immigration lawyer. I've been practicing immigration law for almost 30 years, and what he did for pro bono, we do every day. KIND is a wonderful organization. It was actually started back in Washington, D.C. about a decade ago. Angelina Jolie was actually a moving force behind KIND and has grown into a national force for the representation of children, which we've seen a massive increase in since about 2013. You hear about the flood of people at the border. A couple things about that. It's not a flood, and they're children, and usually single moms or moms that are fleeing violence. And what they're coming from are countries that are literally in the midst of chaos. Primarily because the governments of those countries cannot control the international criminal elements. And in an interesting twist, Department of Homeland Secretary John Kelly, who is the secretary today, while he was general in the Army, he actually gave testimony in Congress in 2014 about the three countries, what we call the Northern Triangle, Guatemala, Honduras, and El Salvador, which are literally in the midst of chaos because of what we did by deporting all these gang members to these countries whose governments and police departments could not control. And therefore, they began to get serious control over various elements of the economy and society, begin recruiting people in there through violence, and then cause people to flee. It's this terrible nightmare cycle of violence that's going through there. And we have, as the United States, have played a major part in that. And one of the reasons I was a little bit late tonight was because of a case just like this, with a really tragic twist, where a young man came here at 16, did not get help. Because while he was in jail, he admitted to committing two murders when he was 11 and 12 years old because a gang forced him to do it in Guatemala. I mean, that's the type of situation a lot of these kids are fleeing from. I mean, this kid is no more a murderer than you and I are. And whether he even did it or not, it's unclear what an 11 or 12-year-old thinks may or may not have happened from something they were forced to do. This kid's about this tall anyway. I can't imagine how tiny he was as an 11-year-old. And you see this type of violence, this type of problems in these countries coming up here, but you understand behind all that are typically sweet, good kids who had a terrible opportunity, terrible options in life. And as a country, we have to decide how we're going to handle that, how we're going to treat these kids, how we're going to treat these moms coming up across the border. There's about, an average in the last 4 years, about 65,000 people that have come each year. When you compare that to the floods of people leaving Syria, millions of people leaving, into countries like Jordan, which has 12 million people, 3 million of which are refugees, and you take 65,000 children and women into a country of 320 million people, I think we can do better than we're currently doing. The SIJ program, this Special Immigrant Juvenile Program, was set up by Congress back in 2000 as a way to recognize that there are some kids coming here that don't deserve to be punished because they're children. And this program was set up to allow for 10,000 of these visas every single year for kids. And right now there's actually a waiting line for kids who come from Guatemala, Salvador, and Honduras because there's so many more than the 10,000 that are coming. But generally speaking, if kids get up here and they get here before they're 16 and they have either a single parent or no parents, they can participate in this program. But President Trump is changing that rule such that these two kids will not be able to participate in the program in the future. So if you have a mom up here, they will no longer consider that to be a special immigrant juvenile case. It will have to be an orphan or having been abandoned by both their parents. But immigration law, I mean, as you all know, every day it's in the news. I mean, it's really crazy. Every day I wake up, and what crazy thing has happened today in immigration law that's going to fill my office with the people? And to give you an example, the panic that what's happened since the administration has changed in people. In any given month, my office may do 200 consultations with new clients. In February, we did 520. I mean, 1 month, right when the new president comes in, people literally begin to panic. And it's not because the new president is enforcing new law. This is all law that's been around for 20 years. And in fact, President Obama, as many of you know, is a deportation president. He deported 3 million people. And his first 5.5 years in office was super aggressive, just as aggressive as the current president. But what was different is the rhetoric. And the rhetoric has scared people. Most Americans, and many of you, I imagine, are wildly clueless about how the immigration process works and about what people go through to legally immigrate here, or why they come illegally to the United States, or even what current illegal immigration patterns are to the United States. It boils down to something very simple. Our current immigration laws do not reflect the economic, social, or familial reality of the 21st century. The last time we really effectively looked at our immigration laws was 1990. And really, most of our immigration laws are based upon the Immigration Act of 1952. Even going back to 1990, you know, what's different between America in 2017 and 1990? You know, mostly everything about how our economy works, our society works. And what we see is the results today of a broken immigration system for the last 27 years. And yet neither party makes an effort to fix it. Both parties are to blame with this. And immigration is weirdly not necessarily a partisan issue. There are people in both parties that would build a big wall around America and stretch somebody over the top and let nobody in both parties. And there's others that would open the gates wide and let everybody in. And then there are others that have a more common sense approach to how we should have functioned as an economy. I mean, I believe immigration should reflect the societal needs and desires, our economic needs and desires, and also benefit America long term. And oddly enough, you know, maybe Trump's the guy to make that happen at this point. You know, when he talks about deporting the bad hombres, I love that phrase, the bad hombres. We're going to get the hombres malos. We're going to get them out of the country. And then he picks up moms for driving without a license or stops somebody because their tag light's out. Did you know you have a tag light? Did you know that? Every morning when he's on documents, he's got to check their tag light, make sure the tag light's not out so they don't get stopped that day. So it's not just bad hombres that get deported. There's good people being deported, at least being put into deportation. And people are scared. Now here's the really weird thing about this whole change that I'll go to the next question.
Well, now before you get to the change, I just want to sort of, because there's obviously been a change.
I could talk forever on this, I probably noticed that.
But sort of, so pre-February, you've been doing this for 30 years, Jonathan, you've been doing this for a handful of years. What would you say were the most sort of significant issues you faced in this practice before the new administration? Because as you said, this has been an issue that's haunted us.
Well, you have to look at it from two different perspectives. You have to look at it from the legal immigration side and the undocumented immigration side. Because they're really two different types of immigration. From an employer perspective, we represent lots of employers that bring in people because they can't find qualified U.S. workers, and it's not just Indian software engineers. There's lots of different jobs for which we're not educating enough people, including doctors. We don't have enough doctors in America. There's been a stifling amount of law that says you can only bring in, for example, 65,000 workers a year that are professionals. Yet the demand for that is 250,000. You have 250,000 employers filing for visas for 250,000 men and women that they need to hire, but being told, there's a lottery, and if you get lucky, you'll get your person. I mean, that's not really a way to run an economy, particularly when you're not finding ways to get those people in through other methods. From the undocumented side, what we've seen and what's been different, what's really different today than 3 years ago, is how people are treated through the deportation process. Even our deportation system itself is literally broken. President Trump announced a couple days ago they're going to send 50 immigration judges to the border to deal with the border problem. And that ignores a couple of important points. One, those 50 judges already have complete dockets here in Atlanta or New York or Norfolk, Virginia. And what happens to those cases? Well, they get put to the back of the calendar, which right now is 2021, 2022. Which seems like a long way away, and it is. And they go to the border, but those border cases still are subject to due process, and they're not gonna hear a case tomorrow and then decide it. That's gonna be 3, 4, 5, 6 months of time they're stuck there. So the system, the deportation cell system itself is causing greater delays by us adding in more people into the system.
So aren't the judges intended to be working mostly on expedited removals?
Well, expedited rights is an interesting point.
You can explain.
Well, this is, you know, again, our immigration law is just really wildly complex. In 1996, those of you that have gray hair may remember contract with America. I always get those confused. Part of that was to make it really tough on illegal immigration. And that came out of a California governor's race with Pete Wilson, where he rode an anti-immigration, Prop 187, to victory in California. It was the last time a real Republican won anything in California. It took that in the Congress, and they passed something called IRA, which is the Illegal Immigration Reform Act and Immigrant Responsibility Act of 1996. How you reform illegal immigration, I still haven't quite figured out. But and it did a couple things in that bill that you just talked about. One was, if you are just coming in the country, or you've only been here for 2 years, and you're coming to work illegally, you can be put through what's called expedited removal. And actually, you don't need a judge to do this. Immigration, what is now Immigration and Customs Enforcement, the old INS, now ICE, can literally just say, you don't, less than 2 years, you're removed. And they could take you to the border and deport you, or they could put you on a plane and deport you from the United States. That law is effective anywhere in the U.S., but until right now, they've never used it beyond the actual physical border. It's never been used in Iowa. What's that?
Under the Obama administration, it was 2 weeks, not 2 years. The law says 2 years.
Look, 2 years.
But it was being enforced as 2 weeks.
Oh, really? I hadn't seen any of that. I mean, typically what they would catch somebody at the border, like your girls, they would say, hey, you're from Nicaragua, we're going to ER you. Although they're not supposed to ER minors. They may have ER'd them, I don't know. Not supposed to ER them. And then they could apply for asylum in front of a judge beyond that. But they have a deportation order. It was typically how it worked. But what President Trump has said, we're going to put this law into effect in the whole U.S. So I did a blog about a month ago called The 9 Things You Need to Know About the New Immigration Laws. And that basically was, no matter what you are, whether you're a citizen or whether you're a permanent resident or whether you're a doctor, what documents you need to carry with you. I got 2 million reads of that blog. I've never had a blog get that many reads before. People were panicked. What do we need to carry with me? And people that have been here, they're undocumented, my advice is carry documents with you that show you've been here longer than 2 years. Because if you have the documents, they can't deport you right away. So that was instituted in that law. Now, a couple of the things that law did that actually created more problems for us as far as undocumented immigration. Look at 96. There is at the time about 2.5 to 3 million undocumented people. And if you go back another decade to 1986, which is when we had an amnesty, that's when I went to law school in 86, and 86, Congress said, look, if you've been here for three years, and you pay us $65, we'll give you a green card. That's amnesty. I mean, that's just flat on amnesty. And that cleared up about 2.8 million of the then 3 million undocumented workers in America. So when that got done in 1990, we had about 500,000 people there here undocumented. By 1996, we had 3 million people again. Well, why? Why all of a sudden we had all this? Because even though Congress said we're going to make every employer in America an immigration agent, so anybody who's ever worked here in the last 30 years has filled out an immigration form. You filled out an I-9. That I-9 was created as part of amnesty to make sure that the employer was only hiring legitimate U.S. workers without any way to verify the documents that were being used or employers that were ignoring the law. People poured in because the amnesty, this is just, when you think about it, in retrospect, you go, of course this makes sense. We gave 2.5 million green cards to people who did really crappy jobs. They were working in the field. They were plucking chickens. They were planting crops. Do you think they kept doing that when they got their green cards? Or do you think they actually got better jobs? Okay, they got better jobs. So who was going to do that work? So what amnesty didn't do was account for the future flow. Who's going to come in and take these jobs? Just ignored it. So, and our border at the time was very, very porous, visible, really. People just came in and took those jobs. So by 96, oh my gosh, we thought we fixed this. So the law did 3 things that caused the problem today. One, it said if you came illegally, you can't get a green card here. So if you, let's say you came and you married a U.S. citizen, you have to go back home. Okay, that's not a problem. I don't have any problem with that. You got to get some punishment for coming in. The second thing it did, though, said if you came illegally and you were here longer than a year and then you leave, you can't come back for 10 years. Well, that's kind of a problem. Because why, if I'm married to a citizen, I'm going to go back home for 10 years? And then the third thing it did was that if you came in twice illegally, so you just came in illegally, and then back in the day, in the 90s, it was Christmas time. Oh, well, I'll go home. It's Christmas time. It's the way the border worked back in the day. They leave and come back. If you enter twice illegally, you permanently barred the rest of your life. So as people started to realize these laws were in effect, they'd come and then leave. And then we started increasing the border enforcement. I mean, the first terrorist attack that caused increased enforcement on the border was not 9/11. It was back in 1993. And the first World Trade Center attack. That caused a massive increase in border enforcement, and it became harder and harder to come in. So once you came in, you didn't leave. So we went from 500,000 to 3 million. They passed this law, and by 2000, there's 8 million people here. And then by 2005, there's 11 million people here. Because the reality is our immigration laws didn't let people who had normally in the past been able to fix their problem, either because they had kids when they were 21, or they got married to a U.S. citizen, or their employer wanted to sponsor them, they literally stopped that. They stopped the natural order of how immigration worked prior to that. So it tripled, quadrupled the number of undocumented immigrants in America. And most Americans just remained oblivious to it until illegal immigration came to your neighborhood. And I moved to Georgia in 1993, 3 years before the Olympics. Remember Billy Payne? We're going to invite the world to Atlanta. And we did. And they didn't go home. They stayed and brought their cousins. They said, oh my goodness, this is a great place to live. There's jobs here. I like to remind people of, why do we have a carpet industry in Georgia? Because of immigration. If anybody's from Dalton or been to Dalton recently, 55% of Whitfield County is Latino. The only reason carpet still exists in America is because of immigration to Dalton. And trust me, most of them were undocumented. Why do we still process chickens in Georgia? How many of you have told your kids, well, Bobby, you know, you need to drop out of high school and get up to the chicken mill, pluck some chickens, eviscerate some of those bad boys? No, we don't tell our kids to do that. But you like eating chicken though, right? And importing chicken from China is kind of hard still, but we have chickens because of immigration, illegal immigration. Why do we build all those houses in Gwinnett and Cobb County? It didn't happen because we were nailing stuff together. No, it was, again, immigration. And the vast majority of that's illegal immigration. And it began to change. Well, my kids are now going to school with Latinos. Well, I don't like the fact there's, you know, these signs are all in Spanish. And there was this big backlash. And that's when people started complaining about the impact of illegal immigration. When it affected California, nobody cared. When it affected Georgia, well, there's an anti-immigration movement. And all this goes back to the way the federal laws are written. They're just terrible laws.
So let's talk about federal law again. We're now in the world of the second executive order, Jonathan. Could you talk about the constitutional issues around both the first and second executive orders? And maybe, I assume people are familiar with the executive orders, but maybe just...
But there's a lot more than two, by the way. There's actually five on immigration, okay. But...
You're talking about the two Muslim...
The bans.
The seven countries and then the six countries.
First executive order for 90 days banned anyone from seven majority Muslim countries. And when I say majority, we're talking between 90% and 99%. You hear a lot about Christians in some of these countries, and there's only 1% left, so there's not a whole lot. It shut down the refugee program for 120 days. It indefinitely barred Syrian refugees, which is where the vast majority of refugees are from, and did a bunch of other things. It had a provision that when the refugee resettlement program start up again, there will be a priority for members of persecuted minority religions in whatever countries they come from. Of course, most immigrants come from majority Muslim countries, but it wasn't a pro-Christian provision, except when the president went on the Christian Broadcasting Network to talk about how he's going to help Christian refugees.
And there was Rudy Giuliani, too. I mean, there was multiple reasons.
Well, no, he talked about Muslim ban.
That's true. Yeah,
the saying, we're going to let the Christians in, because they're having too hard a time getting in, was Trump himself. And it provided that the reason we're doing this is because there's a long history of immigrants being involved in terrorism. Of course, no one from any of the seven countries had ever been involved in a terrorist attack in the U.S., but there's a long history of terrorism, and therefore we're going to have the Department of Homeland Security and the Department of State and Department of Defense spend the next 90 days figuring out how to put in a extreme vetting, to put in a more secure review system. And for those of you who were in the exchange room with me, the system that we had, which was not extreme vetting, took a year and a half to 2 years and mountains of documents, and were basically very hard to do without a lawyer, but nonetheless we've come up with something more. That first order, removals under it were stayed, the order came down on a Friday, Saturday night, removals under it were stayed by a judge in Brooklyn in the case that I was part of. Shortly thereafter, the state of Washington got a nationwide order staying the entire order. There were kind of, I think there were 28 cases filed against the order. There were a number of other orders. The Trump administration took the state of Washington order up to the Ninth Circuit, where they got slammed, and decided that discretion being the better part of valor, it was time to come up with a new order, which took, despite the fact that this was an emergency, despite the fact that this had to go in place immediately, despite the fact that the first order became effective immediately, meaning people in the air with valid visas no longer could enter the country, including my client, took 6 weeks to come up with a new order. The signing of it was put off for another week because it was supposed to get signed the day after the, it's not the State of the Union, I guess, the address to Congress that Trump gave, and that went well, so they wanted to bask in that a little longer.
It didn't last very long.
Came down with the second order. While they're working on this, senior policy advisor Stephen Miller is on the air saying, these are, it's the same order, these are just technical corrections to deal with what the courts want, but same policy, same order. The day the order was signed, Sean Spicer, said that, you know, this is the same policy that we've done before, but we had to fix some things. Actually, Trump later was to say this is a watered-down order, and I like the original one first. New order. Took out the preference for Christian refugees. They figured out that was a significant problem. It took out the ban on Iraqis, and what we hear is the reason that that came out was, again, because of people like my client who had been interpreters or otherwise worked with the Army and the Embassy and the U.S. government in Iraq, who had a special program, the SIV program, to let them into the country, and who were being stopped and sent back. And between General Kelly and General Mattis, both of whom understood the role that SIV visa holders had played in keeping troops safe, were, to say they were very upset is to understate.
I think the word is appalled.
No, it's a stronger,
outraged. Appalled.
We're outraged. And the simplest solution to that was to take Iraq back out. They added a bunch of language in the front saying, this is not a religious ban. This is not based on religion.
You have to read it. It's really interesting.
They gave as an example for why they were bringing in the ban two Iraqi nationals who had been immigrants. Of course, Iraq is out now, who had been arrested because they had been involved in bombings while they were in Iraq, and a Somali citizen who had planned to attack a Christmas celebration who had come here as a small child. Something extreme betting would not have picked up, and over the course of his life had been radicalized. While this was going on, also leaked out of DHS were two reports, one of which said that basing extra vetting on country of origin is not a useful or effective way to screen out potential terrorists. And I've forgotten what the other one was. The other one also said the ban.
Yeah, it says the ban was a joke. It basically, the ban is not going to work.
Second order comes down. The lawsuits continue. State of Hawaii is one of the first ones up. And they get an order saying a ban is a ban. Basically what the order says, there's sort of been a change from the first order to the second order. First order, the core claims were mostly due process. The due process issues were resolved when the second ban no longer applied to legal permanent residents, people already living in the country.
And it wasn't effective immediately either.
Right, it wasn't effective immediately. So we shifted to the Establishment Clause, which is the real problem with the ban. You know, it's a Muslim ban, and that violates the Establishment Clause of the First Amendment. You're not allowed to prefer one religion over another. The district court in Hawaii said, no, this is clearly all one thing, and issued a stay of the ban. Both the ban and the refugee section, district court in Maryland, in a case brought by the group I worked with, the International Refugee Assistance Project, got an order that just applied to the Muslim ban but didn't apply to the resettlement of refugees, and also had special provisions about immigrants. The district court back in the state of Washington was asked by the state of Washington to extend the existing order to the new order, and it looked at it and said, you know, the order's kind of changed, you really ought to give me a new set of briefs.
Yeah.
And so they wouldn't extend it, and that case is going into briefing. And finally, on Friday, a court in Virginia, where one judge had issued a national ban, a different judge refused to issue a ban on the basis that it wasn't clear from the record that the plaintiffs would win, and therefore there's no injunction, but we'll go figure this out. The big issue, the big constitutional issue in the Establishment Clause cases is between two Supreme Court cases. One is Kleindienst versus Mandel, which gave a great deal of deference to the executive branch in immigration matters, and said as long as a provision relating to immigration is facially legitimate and bona fide, the court will not look behind it and will not engage in psychoanalysis.
That's an old case, by the way. It's been around for a very long time.
Yes, but it is the reason for all the Ninth Circuit dissents.
Yep.
The much more recent case is a case called McCreary, which said that in determining whether a law is bona fide, and the key thing here is it splits it up. Instead of saying on its face it's legitimate and bona fide, there's a lot of cases that say it has to be on its face legitimate and it has to be bona fide. And to figure out whether it's bona fide, you have to figure out whether it's in bad faith or not. And to do that, you're not allowed to psychoanalyze, but you are allowed to look at the history of the provision, the legislative history, the sequence of events that led to the law. You do it from the point of view of an objective observer. You're not trying to get in anyone's head. And you're only allowed to look at readily available objective facts. And most courts have said, okay, applying McCreary, let's look at the sequence of events. Trump says he wants to keep all Muslims out. Muslims are terrorists. He says he wants a Muslim ban. Then he switches it to a ban on people from Muslim countries, saying, you know, I've heard I can't do a Muslim ban, so I'm going to expand the order, not change it, and we're going to apply to territories. So where I used to say Muslims, think territories. You have Giuliani saying, Trump came to me and said, get together a bunch of smart lawyers and find me a way to do a Muslim ban. And the way we did was we did it based on countries.
Danger. I use the word danger. It's all about danger. This is a great interview on Fox News.
There's a wonderful moment when Trump signed the bill. The executive order is, and why can't I pull this off the top of my head?
When he said,
what's the executive order called?
Oh.
The title.
Oh, the title is a ban on Muslim travel or something. That's completely.
No. It's just something like
keep America safe or something.
Okay, right. Keep America safe and keep terrorists out. And after he signed it, he held it up and he read the title and said, well, we all know what that means.
So let me ask you.
So they looked at that sequence and said, it's a ban. The sequence continues because Stephen Miller said, we're just making technical changes. It's not really changed. Sean Spicer said, it's doing the same thing, but we had to fix it because of the courts. Trump has said it's a washed out version of the ban I really liked. And most courts following McCreary have said, well, you know, a ban is a ban is a ban. A few courts have followed the Mandel case and said, oh, well, we really shouldn't get involved in this.
So this case, we presumably, unlike the first executive order, where the sort of simple solution was issue, do a second executive order and try to clean it up, I doubt the plan is now to do a third one. Oh. So presumably this issue will end up at the Supreme Court. And do you have a sense about what will happen there? And the question is,
how many judges will be on the Supreme Court at that time?
Are the president's hands tied now? I mean, does the sort of poison fruit stop him from ever doing something?
McCreary makes clear that no one's hands are ever tied forever. Yeah. If you break the sequence, if you break the history, if you show a bona fide purpose, if you explain why we're excluding all these people from the countries where we did not have immigrants who attacked the U.S. and who killed people here, you know, if you create a bill that is objectively in good faith, then you can do it. I don't know how you fix the executive order and continue to exclude those countries. There's another problem which is very quickly going to hit, which is the ban was supposed to be a temporary ban of 90 days so that the government could fix its vetting process. The first bill was January. The fixing vetting was never stayed. So 90 days from January 27th, it's supposed to be all over and we're supposed to be able to let people back in. One of the dark secrets of the executive orders is they are effectively permanent bans.
They are.
Because the executive order says that once, gives an example of Iraq and how Iraq, there's a strong U.S. diplomatic presence and army presence, and they're cooperating with the U.S. on documentation, and they're cooperating with the U.S. identifying terrorists, and therefore we're taking them out of the first ban. Of the six remaining countries, two of them don't have embassies, so how they would ever meet the requirements is unclear. Two of them don't have diplomatic relations with the U.S., three of them don't have embassies, and the fourth is the Sudan. It is not clear how any of the countries are ever going to comply with the requirements on the face of the executive order. And that means you effectively have a permanent ban.
It's absolutely permanent because what they said in there, after 90 days, we're going to tell you, Iran, what we want. Let's say this, you know what? We would love to have all your secret military police records of people, and you have 60 days to give those to us. Well, obviously Iran's not going to do that. And so, permanent ban. So every one of these countries were going to be permanently excluded from the process. But the thing is, this: if you really wanted to exclude people from these countries, you didn't have to do this. You just tell your embassy, hey, slow it down to a crawl. Obama did it. I mean, refugees back about 8 years, six, 8 years ago, he slowed them to a crawl from Iraq. I mean, basically, we didn't do them for a few months. I mean, and they did it because they were updating how they vet people, updating how they check people. So this is all about politics and not about actual effectively slowing down or identifying terrorists from coming into the country. And it's true, if you think about it from a logical perspective. If you're a refugee from a country, generally it's because that country's either in the middle of a civil war or it's just a nightmare. So have we ever really been able to get records on refugees such that we know their complete, absolute history? Think back to Bosnia in the 90s when Clinton was there. We let in thousands of Bosnian refugees. There was no way to get that information from Serbia at the time. It just wasn't possible. And yet there's no Bosnian, you know, terrorists walking around the United States. Terrorists, generally speaking, the vast majority of them are women and children. There are some men, but I think 75% of them are women and children. And this is really more about politics than it is about actually stopping people from coming in the country.
I'm going to sort of open up the floor for questions. Barry?
I'm talking about consistency. I don't believe Saudi Arabia was one of the bans, were they?
Correct.
Correct.
Ah, well, there is politics because most of the 9/11 perpetrators were from Saudi. How do they square that?
Well, they don't have to explain why they put people on the list. Nobody asked that question in court. You know, the reality, it's all about politics. Why, you know, it's about politics.
Yeah.
You know it's about politics. You know, you mentioned why Iraq got off the list. You mentioned, well, they were cooperating. The other real reason, I think, we have 5,000 U.S. troops in Iraq. And who are they fighting against? With? They're fighting with the Iraqis. So the guy in the foxhole next to you looks at you and goes, yeah, you know, I don't like you so much now I can't go to your country anymore. I mean, there was a military reason why we took Iraq off that list, not just the other reason.
There was a declaration that was filed in a lot of the cases by 10 former secretaries of state, directors of national
security,
intelligence, directors of homeland security, basically saying the ban is dangerous. It is very dangerous for our troops. Our troops are in a lot of these countries fighting with locals who we've now just said, you know, we don't like you, we don't want you in. And, you know, that's unsustainable.
Mm-hmm. Sure.
Just kind of question for both of you gentlemen. What got you both started on this path? I know we have a brief history, but, like, what was your personal reason why this means so much to you?
Well, I'll tell you why I got into immigration law. I was a new lawyer out of school back in late 1980s, and was waiting for the bar exam results to come out, which is, for anybody who's been to law school knows, not exactly the best time of your life, as you're waiting whether you're going to make more money or not make any money at all. And a friend of mine at the law firm was, I said, hey, there's this really cool place you can go called immigration court. Because I wanted to litigate, I wanted to go to court. And there's no rules of evidence, there's no discovery, and you don't have to be admitted to the bar. As long as you're working with somebody who is, as long as you went to law school, you can take a pro bono case. And so I took a pro bono case. I mean, this is the 80s, most of you weren't born yet, but in the 80s, we were in the midst of causing lots of foment in Central America, where there was lots of civil wars. And so I was given a case of a little Guatemalan farmer who didn't even speak Spanish. He spoke Quiche, right? I spoke Spanish. We got a translator who spoke Quiche in Spanish, and did this three-way thing. And I took his case. I was living in Arizona at the time. And I just fell in love with this family and this guy. We ended up winning that asylum case. Passed the bar right after that. And I told my firm, I want to do some more of this. So I took, over the course of the next 2 years, 7 pro bono asylum cases, which I won all of them. What happens when you win a case is people think you're the greatest lawyer in the world, even though you have no idea what you're doing as a new lawyer, right? You're the greatest lawyer in the world. So they send your firms to you. And after 2 years, I had an immigration practice. And I just gathered the information to learn more about immigration as a whole, and then just took it from there. For me, it was doing volunteer work, pro bono work. I have found, especially as lawyers, we have an obligation to give back to the communities that we're in and to help people that have no way of affording the services of a competent, good lawyer. And I see nowhere a greater need, honestly, than in the immigration field. where there is a complete dearth of immigration lawyers. That's kind of how I got into it.
Was looking for pro bono options and it appealed to me. Again, I came in working with the unaccompanied minors, and so it was a way to work with children without having, if you're going to go into family court, you actually have to actually know what you're doing. Yeah, if you're going to become a guardian ad litem, you'll have to know what you're doing. It is amazing what you can do in immigration court with not a lot of training, and there was an organization that we worked with, the KIND, which provided the training and provided someone to ask questions to when you didn't know what you were supposed to do, and it was rewarding.
And Jonathan shared with me on the way over that, you know, I mean, ultimately we're all immigrants, and his family were.
My wife is a first generation American. Her parents are Holocaust survivors who were refugees from Poland. My family went back a couple more generations, but we were refugees from the Ukraine, and particularly, you know, with my wife, yeah, just as now we have the Muslim ban, and now we have the attempts to keep, you know, Latin America out of the country. In the 30s, Jews weren't allowed in the country. You know, there's a famous ocean liner, the St. Louis, which was full of Jewish refugees that was turned around and sent back, and most of the people on it ended up in the camps and ended up dead. They recently found Anne Frank's father had tried to get a visa to bring the family here, and it was denied because he didn't get lucky under the Jewish quotas at the time. And, you know, there have been, you know, the Chinese, the Vietnamese,
you know, we in America,
there's a long history of excluding the people who most need to come here. And in every case, or almost every case, people who, when they did get here, you know, contributed to America, contributed to our diversity and the strength of the country, who made, you know, really important contributions. Yeah, and it's, you know, likely true of the immigrants who are trying to get here from the Middle East. It's true of, you know, as you've mentioned, you know, what would our economy do without the illegal immigrants, the undocumented immigrants from Latin America?
Well, you know, it's interesting. Do you like your iPhone? Thank a Syrian refugee. Just Steve Jobs' dad was a Syrian refugee. I mean, you like Google? Thank the Russians that started that company. I mean, much of what we enjoy today is because of immigration. As a country, we love immigrants from the past. My grandfather came through Ellis Island, or some such made-up tale. My grandparents were immigrants. I'm a second-generation American. And they were lucky to get through the very strict quotas that we had in the 1920s from Germany to come on over here. But at the same time, we've never, as a country, liked new immigrants. Benjamin Franklin was terrified and very upset that we did not include English as official language in the Constitution, because he feared we'd all be speaking German before the century was over. Because all these German immigrants were pouring into Pennsylvania. You know them today as the Pennsylvania Dutch, right? But that's the way we've been. And it just goes back. Every generation has their immigrants they don't like, whether it's the Chinese or the Irish or the Italians, or it just doesn't matter. We've always been there. And today, it's, you know, now it's everybody. But without immigrants, we are not even a country. We're not even a country.
Yeah, you mentioned.
We got lots of hands up over here.
I have a question about sort of the Mercury case as it sort of pertains to the Muslim bans. Some of the rhetoric and concerns that I've sort of just seen in general is that the Mercury case, as it was sort of originally conceived of, was supposed to look at sort of intentionality and sort of like the legislative process, or like people explicitly talking about a law that they were writing. It wasn't ever really intended to be able to sort of look at objective histories as far as like campaign statements. How true is that, and how unprecedented is sort of this use of Mercury to look at campaign statements?
There's another Supreme Court case involving the Ten Commandments in a courthouse where the court, you know, said you can't put up the Ten Commandments in a courthouse, and against the argument that, oh, no, this is, we're going to put up the Ten Commandments, and the Bill of Rights, the Declaration of Independence, a bunch of other formative documents, went back and looked at the Chief Justice's campaign statements. And the Chief Justice, you know, at the courthouse, who had put up this facially neutral display, had campaigned on the fact that he was going to have the Ten Commandments in the courthouse because this is a Christian nation. You know, it's what you said is said about McCreary, it's just not true.
Well, it's interesting about that because if you recall, President Obama had an executive order that was stopped by a court because of the statements he had made. I don't have authority to create an executive order on this. And the Fifth Circuit Court of Appeals shut him down. So this is not unprecedented by any stretch of the imagination. And honestly, the exact same arguments that the GOP used to stop Obama's order, the other side used to stop Trump's order.
Texas
versus the United States. So
let's go on the aisle here.
Hi. So my parents, both of them, are immigrants. And not only are they immigrants, they're refugees from Vietnam. And so my question to you is, because I understand their struggle, what can we do with the struggle now with the immigrants here? How can we help them?
I'll give you my opinion. We need not be quiet. I think we all learned the power of the public voice in the last week in Congress. Immigration is going to come up at its congressional issue and likely will come up this term, probably this next year between March and June. When Congress gets ready to address this issue and wants to eliminate legal immigration, our own Senator, David Perdue, put a bill in called the RAISE Act to eliminate the ability of U.S. citizens to sponsor their parents, their adult children, and for permanent residents to not be able to sponsor their adult children, effectively cutting legal immigration by 50% of the United States. If you think it's important for your parents to bring their siblings or for you to be able to sponsor your parents if you're a new immigrant to America, you have to speak out. Immigrants, when they speak out, aren't very loud. First of all, there's not a lot of immigrants in America. You might think there are, but there's really not. Calls to your senators and your congressmen make a massive difference. Back in 2007, when President Bush was trying to pass immigration reform, I sat in Senator Saxby Chambliss's office waiting to do my lobbying with the senator, and the phone literally rang nonstop for an hour while I was there, and not a single call came in favor of that bill. So what we can do as people that are citizens or children of immigrants, grandchildren of immigrants, if we believe immigration is important to America, when we see things that hurt immigrants, that hurt our future, we need to say something, and we need to be out there and stand for it.
You have the advantage, being in Georgia as opposed to New York, that you've got Republican representatives and senators. Mm-hmm. Yeah. The moderate Republicans who went against the health care bill, a lot of them, because their calls from their constituents were coming in 500 to 1, 1,000 to 1 against the bill, and particularly for congressmen, if you think that doesn't scare them, of course it scares them. It's important to be heard that way. It's important when there are protests that you can get to be part of that. You know, it's important to speak out.
You can also volunteer places like KIND. In Georgia, we have the Georgia Asylum and Immigrant Network. We have the Latin American Association. We have Catholic Charities. You don't have to be a lawyer to volunteer with them in helping their legal cases. Right now, we're in the process of gathering. We need workers to go in and interview people on a certain type of case that we're working on through the folks at the Latin American Association. There's work to be done with immigrants. The other thing you can do with immigration, especially if you're a first-generation immigrant, is to make sure your parents become citizens. And to those that are struggling learning English, to teach English. One of the great things you hear in America, you need to come here and learn English. But we have no program to learn English in America. It just doesn't exist. There's no national funding. This is the National English Language Program. It doesn't exist. We need teachers. We need volunteers. We need to create programs that create new citizens through the process. I mean, people that come here as refugees or come here as visa holders or those that immigrate intentionally or unintentionally want to be part of the fabric of America. And I'll tell you one of the last things that you can be part of. I represent DACA kids. These are the kids that President Obama created a category back in 2012
to stop them from shutting down his campaign offices, by the way, which is what they were doing all over the country. He created a program. It says if you came here before 2007, which was 5 years before, you came before you were 15, you're in school, you graduate from high school, I'm going to give you, if you come forward, give me your ID, give me your photo, give me your fingerprints, we do a background check, we're going to give you a work card, and we're not going to deport you for 2 years. We're going to renew that. President Trump is committed. He's not going to do away with that program. But in Georgia, we told those kids, we are not going to let you pay in-state tuition. We're not going to let you do it. We don't care that you grew up here. We don't care that you pay taxes here. We don't care that your parents pay taxes here. You're not paying in-state tuition. So I sued the Board of Regents on behalf of, 4 years ago, 37 of these kids. We ended up losing that case at the Georgia Supreme Court on sovereign immunity. Really? When's the last time you heard sovereign immunity? Never. Okay, so it's like a legal issue I heard 25 years before. I resued them again last year, and this time we won. And a Superior Court judge has found that these kids get to pay in-state tuition. Now that's on hold while we appeal, while the government appeals that case. But we're going to need help with these kids to even help them pay in-state tuition. We're going to eventually win this case because it's the moral thing that has to happen. It's the right thing that has to happen. But they're going to need help reaching out to the younger kids, helping them stay in school, fight college. And we as citizens, we as individuals who value the future of our country through education have to go to these kids who could be easily drop out because they despair about going to college. I can't afford to pay out-of-state tuition. We have to tell them, no, stay in school, get good grades, there's going to be a path forward. So that's another thing you can do is help these DACA kids.
Sure.
So what I find is that a lot of the talk focuses on the political rhetoric that we see. All right, this is about terrorists, or this is about certain countries or religions. The reality is most of the people who are immigrating in here are here, coming here for a job, for an opportunity. And so is there an organization or a group of people that are working with the business chambers on a national level or a state level to say, look, your businesses want employment. If we don't have this population to do these jobs, our prices are going to spike up. We can't be competitive. It would seem to me that that would be a well-positioned organization to have these chambers say, look, we need a path to have some clarity around how these people can be documented and employed.
That's a great question. It's called the National Immigration Forum. They have a group called Badges, Bibles, and Business. The true freebies. They're going to have a seminar here in Georgia in April. They are supported by other national organizations like the U.S. Chamber of Commerce, to bring together churches, businesses, and law enforcement to demand that Congress fix immigration law. So yeah, there's a seriously strong movement out there. But immigration reform and fixing immigration is all about timing. You have to time it in Congress in a way that it's done before they leave for, let's say, an August recess, because they don't touch radioactive legislation 2 months before an election. But you can't also start it too early in administration because it's not that important of an issue for people. So that's why I said if you look at early next year, you're going to start seeing a lot of movement towards this bill that might come out there. And some of it's going to be good and some of it's going to be bad. But, I mean, what you point out is vitally important. If we literally deported 11 million people, I mean, I hope you like chicken that costs like $40 a bucket. Or you don't like fresh fruit because, well, that's going to go away. And not just that, it's also about families, it's about schools, it's about education. So we need your involvement in these organizations, but the National Immigration Forum is probably the premier organization on this issue. Nonpartisan, they talk to both sides of the aisle, they've got a great reputation, there are lots of good people in that organization.
Take a couple more. You go back here, hand up in the middle. Ken sees. Yep.
So you mentioned something earlier about how immigration has had a lot to like our economics, like the economics of our country, and it kind of reminded me similar to President Trump's use of the word meritocracy when talking about immigration reform. And on the other hand, you also were talking a lot about how difficult it is with quotas, especially in the past when we've had quotas on, which our group has been, has been having the most trouble getting immigration. So how do we find that kind of, I guess, middle ground? Because on the one hand, we want to accept the people who, in Trump's terms, are the best of the best for our own economic benefit, but we also y'all want to discount people, link people to suffering and potentially death or danger simply because they haven't had the opportunity to really perfect their talent or skill. So how do we navigate that?
That's a great question. Actually wrote an article on that a couple years ago, the five things you need to do to fix the immigration. Start with the second point first, which is the people that don't necessarily have the skills but want to come to America. Most of the people that immigrate through family-based immigration generally are lesser skilled people, generally speaking. But let's say you let in somebody who's a nuclear scientist. Okay, we want this guy in America. Are you going to tell him he can't bring his parents in when they're 65 or 75 years old? I mean, the reality is, if you want to attract the best in a merit-based system, in economic-based immigrants, you also want them to be able to bring their families, but you want them to do that in an economically responsible way. We have a program right now. If you immigrate a family member, you sign a contract with the United States government that says, one, they can't go on public benefits for 5 years. So even if, until they're either a citizen or 5 years of permanent, no public benefits. And if they do use it early somehow, which is, I don't know how in the modern age how that's going to happen, you agree to pay the government back. I mean, that's already in existing law. Now, the downside of that is the government never enforces it. So even if it's happening, the government's not spending resources to make that happen. But you can have a system where you're attracting the best and the brightest. You're bringing in the people that are good. But we also need people to pick our crops if we want to keep farming in America. We also need people to make the carpet if we want to make carpet in America. We need to bring in bodies to grow. There's no recorded history in the world where an economy of a shrinking population grows. You look at Japan over the last 30 years. Their economy literally has been stagnant since the 80s. Why? They've had zero population growth. They don't have any immigration in Japan. So they have no population growth. The only real significant population growth in America is immigration. If you took out all the immigrants in the last 30 years, the U.S. would essentially have zero population growth. So much of the economic growth over the last 30 years has been because of immigration. And then as far as bringing in the best of the best, we already do bring in the best because we have the best education system in the world. We have over 950,000 foreign students in the United States today, many times more than any other country, because our education system is the best. But we only allow a very small portion of them to stay here every year. So while we're attracting the best, we're not keeping the best because our system doesn't do that. We need to change that. And I would finally say there are still a lot of great people here. In the United States last year, we had 8 winners of the Nobel Prize in the United States. They were all immigrants, every single one of them. And if you go back the last decade, you will see 80, 90% of the Nobel Prize winners from the U.S., almost all immigrants.
50% of the tech startups in Silicon Valley are immigrants.
I mean, it's just the nature. Immigrants create businesses at a faster rate. They grow businesses at a faster rate. They're much more entrepreneurial, much less likely to commit crime, much less likely to go on welfare. I mean, that's just the nature of being an immigrant. Because lazy people don't walk across the desert. They don't. They just don't. I look at my grandparents. They came from this crappy little town in northern Germany, which I visited about 15 years ago. And once I got there, I realized why they left. And yet they got here. They literally never stopped working until they died. And that's what immigrants do. We need that. That's why we're the greatest country in the world for economic development and growth and opportunity, because we offer that to people. And countries that don't, stagnate. Great question. Yeah. Elect me and I'll fix it.
Back on the side here.
After the second battle was shut down, Trump said that it was a question of judicial review, that's what the jury or the judgment was. So my question is, how do you respond to some person who says that when you curtail the executive orders of the president, you're actually kind of disrespecting the mandate of the U.S. democracy?
If that's a disrespect of the U.S. democracy, then why do we have a court system? Trump doesn't seem to understand the most basic court case called Marbury versus Madison, which basically said the Supreme Court has the right to declare laws unconstitutional. Somebody's got to be a judge. It's in the Constitution. Now, just because the majority of Americans want something, and by the way, the majority does not support this, doesn't mean it should be the law. I mean, it needs to be the law if it's legal, if it follows the Constitution. I'd love to hear your take on this, because I've heard him say that. It was like, oh my, as a lawyer, I was just stunned. Then I realized he's not a lawyer. He's a business guy.
It is. Yeah, it is a fundamentally ridiculous argument. It is the role of the judiciary to ensure that what the executive does and what the legislature does complies with the Constitution. There is no one else out there enforcing the Constitution. There is no one else out there saying what is constitutional and what is not. You know, otherwise, you have no Constitution. You have whatever, I mean, what you have is an autocracy. You have whatever the president says, that's what it is, or whatever the legislature says, that's what it is. And in that system, there is no Constitution because there's no one declaring it, there's no one enforcing it.
But isn't it in that way the same way that the judges are the extra constitutional authority in that sense? Because they can overrule.
The judges are part of the Constitution. There are three branches in the Constitution. But that's how the Constitution set it up, because if everyone was democratically elected, then you have tyranny of the majority. Then you have all three branches doing whatever the majority says, which could be slavery is fine, which could be any one of a number of things. The majority is not necessarily right. The majority is not necessarily fair. The majority certainly doesn't necessarily believe in the Bill of Rights or constitutional rights or due process. I'll tell you, the majority of the country thinks that this is a Christian country, and there's absolutely nothing wrong with supporting Christianity over any other religion. But the First Amendment says you shall not establish religion. It says that the government has to have a level playing field for religions, but that's certainly not the majority position in the country.
Yeah, I did hear that. I was stunned by that statement from the president. I was just stunned. Keep in mind, judges they're appointed, but they're confirmed by the Senate. So the majority gets to say whether they're going to be judges or not, and they're picked because they're good men and women. That's why they're picked as judges, not necessarily for their political stance. Generally speaking,
I take a couple. Go ahead, this young lady up front.
So, it's really a struggle to understand how we're going to get out of the situation that we're in when we have 11 million people that are undocumented here, and what is the, is there? I just like to hear what you guys think about is the thing to do, because I think a lot of the resentment that we heard in the, in the electorate during the election was, these people are cutting in line, I've waited in line, I've been waiting to send my kid to college, and now these people come in and they're, cutting in line. And think that mentality exists, but what do you do with the 11
million people? All right, here's my plan. It's really quite simple, actually. One, there is no such thing as a line. There's no line.
I know there's not.
There's no line.
I'm just...
Unless you consider lifetime a line, there's no line.
Yeah.
Of the 11 million that are here, about 70% of them have been here for longer than a decade. Mm-hmm. What you say is simple. Look, if you've been here long, you pick the time, whether it's 5 years, 10 years, whatever, you've been here longer than 5 or 10 years, you need to come forward and show us your tax returns, or you need to pay your taxes and come forward with your tax returns. And in return for that, doing
and
a background
show that you don't have a criminal record.
Okay, do a background
other
check.
Than immigration.
No criminal record, right? No criminal record, or at least nothing that's major. I mean, unfortunately, if you start considering in Georgia driving without a license, a criminal record, then nobody's going to qualify. We call the DWH at my office, driving while Hispanic. You just got to be really careful about that. So you don't have any criminal record, and you're going to pay $1,000, and we're going to give you a work permit. Okay. And then we're going to establish a line. And you can stay in that line. That line might be 10 or 15 years long, but you're going to get your permit and a driver's license. Very few people walk in my office and say, man, I want to become a citizen. You know what they want? They want a driver's license and a work permit. You will solve the 11 million almost overnight. And then you say, okay, we're going to create a program where ultimately, over a period of 10 years, you can pay a certain fine, you can do a certain job, and you will ultimately get a green card, permanent residence. Not citizenship. It's a pathway to legality. You always hear about this, they want to get citizenship. generally speaking, only 40% of people who get green cards become citizens. Generally speaking, you go historically look at the number, it's what it is. They're not going to all become, I don't know, they're all going to come in and become Democratic voters. Also not true. It's also not true. Talking to many of my friends who were undocumented, I was a pastor of a Spanish church for 3 years, and most of my congregants were undocumented, and honestly, most of them probably would have voted Republican. I mean, that's just kind of how many of them are. But
you have these days.
Well, not now. Not now, but before. Before. John Kasich Republicans, okay. If you have a system where they can come forward and do that, you're going to wipe out a huge chunk of the 11 million.
So how does that not end up exactly like 1986?
Because you can't do it in isolation. You have to account for future flow. Mm-hmm. Who is going to do these jobs? The other thing is people think, well, they're just going to come illegally again. Well, that's not true. Because demographics have changed in Latin America.
Right.
Mexico is at not even replacement birth rate anymore. So Mexican women 10, 15, 20, 30 years ago, they had 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 15 kids. Now they have 2. I mean, I talk to my clients that are my age. They've got 6, 8, 10 brothers and sisters. They have 2. And that there's this wave of people ready to come in and pick crops. It doesn't exist anymore. And then people from Central America, that's a separate issue. That's a political issue that is fixable if we had the will to fix it. People aren't flooding up here from Peru and in Colombia, maybe from Venezuela a little bit, but you know, that's, again, a political issue. But the demographic need to find work, it doesn't really exist anymore. We're not going to have that issue. But what you do is you have a legal immigration system that says, you match, I have a need. I'm an employer. I have a need. I need this kind of person. He doesn't exist here. I've run advertisements. All right, you can go pick this guy from that country. And he can come in for 2, 3, 4, 5 years to do this job. And if you want to be permanent, you have to show you still can't find qualified workers. There's ways to do this that are not complicated, that don't involve huge bureaucracies, that solve the problem. What we lack is the political will, because both parties love using this as a tool to help them gain votes.
You, ma'am?
Yes. So, of the refugees that I know, they're almost universally terrified right now, whether they work in a chicken plant or they're medical. So this is sort of a two-part question. A, the refugees who crossed the Canadian border, were they overreacting? And B, if there is a major terrorist attack under Trump, what are the chances are that he is going to implement number one fear of the people that I know, and that is that he'll create detention camps for Muslims?
Well, they could go into the same camps that Obama was going to put gun owners in. Plenty available for that. It's funny. Come on, man. You guys need to be up on modern crazy talk, okay? There's camps are out there. If they're actually refugees, I mean, they're legally in the country, they have no fear. Because after a year, they can become green card holders, and then 4 years later, become citizens, and they're not going to be deported. If they're undocumented, yeah, that's another issue. Could Trump round up people? Sure, he could. Is he physically capable of doing that? Is there money to do that? Is there bodies to do that? Absolutely not. There's no chance. They don't have the bodies. And so this fear, while rational from a subjective point of view, from an objective point of view, is simply not going to happen. We have to help convince our refugee friends that this is not a fear they need to have. Rather, we should use that fear as a motivator for them, one, so the day they are eligible to apply for a green card, which is at that 1 year mark once they're here, and the day they're eligible 4 years later to apply for citizenship. And that's where their true power lies. That's how they can make a difference. That's how they can overcome their fear. I talk to these fearful people every single day. I mean, it's palpable out there. People don't send their kids to school. Did you know that crime reporting in Georgia is down 30% from this year to last year? I mean, it's in immigrant communities. It's down 30%. That's the fear. I'm a victim. I'm not even going to call the police. I'd rather be a victim than subject myself to police who are not going to arrest them if they're the victim of a crime.
And that is the theory behind sanctuary cities.
Exactly.
That, you know, the police should not be detaining crime victims. They should not be detaining people who come forward as witnesses, because then you undermine, you know, general public safety and criminal enforcement.
So, but you're starting to read stories about a dreamer picked up, you know, and I can't tell whether
it has. I mean, dreamers have been picked up since dreamers began, because dreamers are teenage kids who do stupid things. I mean, it's really that simple. I mean, ICE is not looking for kids who are dreamers to deport them. You had the one kid up in Washington in Tacoma. The ICE came for his dad. Okay. Why did they pick him? He had no criminal. They alleged he was a member of a gang because he had a tattoo or something like that. But there's something else to that story. I don't know what it is, but I don't know a single ICE agent that would just randomly pick up a kid.
There was also the girl who was picked up after speaking out.
Yeah, exactly. And what happened there? What was that issue? Well, she had a deportation order, and she didn't have DACA. She had let her DACA lapse. Well, you let your DACA lapse, you don't have DACA anymore. Or didn't have any money. You still don't have DACA anymore, then you're just undocumented, and you can be picked up. Now, was there some element of retaliation there? Without a doubt. Without a doubt. But DACA kids who obey the law, who don't do stupid things, who don't get arrested for things, they have nothing to fear. That is not out there.
And who renewed their DACA.
And renewed their DACA on time. One of the kids I saw today, he had DACA, and he came to me because he got picked up for smoking marijuana. Hope you love Mexico, because you're gone. As soon as ICE finds out, you're gone. I mean, you can't do stupid things. That's just the way it is.
All right, we're going to take two more. Sir?
Okay, so first of all, thank you so much for all the great information you're providing. I am, thank God, I am a refugee from Venezuela. Came here 15 years ago.
Congratulations.
Thanks to the wonderful things that Chavez has done in my country.
It's what an autocracy does right there.
Right. And I like to believe that pretty much everything that we're seeing right now with our president is perception. Perception is everything. And most of us don't quite understand all the deep things of how the justice system works and the three, you know, layers of the government and stuff like that. So as an immigrant, I am a little concerned about the new Supreme Court justice, judge, because we feel that will empower the current administration to continue doing the things that they have so far done against immigrants. So my question to you guys is, what would potentially keep Trump and his government from another type of ban, travel ban? This was a religious ban, but what would keep him from doing a racial ban against Latinos or Mexicans? Because obviously during his campaign, he was very strongly speaking against Mexicans, the whole thing with the wall to start with. So, and the rapists and, you know, all these crazy talk. So as an immigrant, I'm a little concerned how this would affect future people coming from countries like Venezuela.
From issuing the executive order or from enforcing the executive order?
Well, first the executive order, obviously.
From issuing it?
Yes.
You know, only the wise advice of his counselor.
Of his wise counselor.
Right. From enforcing it, you know, that's what lawyers are for. Yeah. My wife put up a little meme on our refrigerator, which I don't usually repeat because I know a lot of cops and firefighters, and I think it's a little excessive, but it says, "Lawyers are the new first responders."
It was cool to be an immigration lawyer.
It's a little much. But
so, what is to prevent sanctuary's the legality of them trying to take money away from sanctuary cities or denying any kind of?
Well, I love the use of the term sanctuary city because there's no such thing. Why would a city say we're not going to work with ICE? That's what it's about. It's really about sheriffs saying, we're not going to recognize an ICE hold, an ICE detainer. Well, there's a reason they're not doing that, which is not getting the media attention. Because they're illegal. At least five district courts in the United States have said that ICE's detainer, which is an administrative request to hold somebody for 48 hours after they have either served their time or after they have paid their bond, is unconstitutional detention. It's a violation of due process. And so those cities have actually paid damages for recognizing the ICE ban. Now, none here in the 11th Circuit, okay? But in other circuits, this has happened because it's a constitutionally defective request.
And most of the sanctuary cities say, if you send us a judicial order, if you send us a judicial warrant, which is constitutional, we will do it. There is, by the way, another less spoken about reason that some of the cities are doing it, which is that no one is reimbursing.
Yeah, that's it. There's no money. You don't get any money back for holding these people.
Right, right. You're gonna hold them for 48 hours. And you don't get paid for it, just like New York doesn't get paid,
yeah,
you know, for the first lady continuing to live in.
Get used to it, man.
Right. 20 days. If we could get Melania out of New York for 20 days, that would fund the National Endowment for the Arts.
Work on that. But, you know, it goes to this. So the sanctuary cities are really about, we're not going to recognize your unconstitutional hold, but if you want to get a warrant, so why doesn't ICE just get a judicial warrant? Because they're lazy. They can get a warrant for every single one of these people. And just on Friday, ICE issued a new policy memo making it easier for themselves to issue detainers. And so But not to get a warrant. And the way these work is, if you are arrested, and Obama put this in place, by the way, if you are arrested for any reason, just whatever reason you're brought to the jail, they take your fingerprints, they run it through the FBI background check, which then also runs it through the ICE's database. ICE then gets alerted if a name pops. Hey, you know, Jose Lopez in Gwinnett County has got arrested for driving while out of license. And they go, oh, we want to put a hold on Jose Lopez because he pops up. Looks like we detained him 25 years ago at the border. We want to talk to him. So they send the request to Gwinnett County, and Gwinnett County puts the hold. So you go pay your bond for your driving without a license, and then ICE will come speak to you within the next 48 hours, and they'll determine whether they're going to detain you or not detain you. That's been around now for, heck, a decade. And so it's not like Trump's doing anything new. He's just using a system that's already in place. But now, where Obama the last couple of years didn't detain people that had no real criminal convictions, he's detaining everybody. Everybody.
Because everyone is a bad hombre.
Yeah. Yeah. I do want to answer this one last question over here about Judge Gorsuch. And, you know, what is the idea that, will he enforce what Trump said? The reality is you never really know what a Supreme Court justice is going to do. You just don't really know where they're going to ask Bush about Justice Souter where they're going to end up on the bench. Gorsuch, to me, seems like a relatively reasonable guy on a lot of different issues. Might not like it. And keep in mind, he was overturned 8-0 on Friday by the Supreme Court. Welcome to the bench, new guy, on one of his decisions. So, yeah, I don't. Gorsuch on immigration, he's only had a few immigration cases, and he's always been very tough on the government in those cases. I don't know. I mean, that's just, yeah, and plus, he hates Chevron. He hates Chevron.
But outside of the immigration area.
Well, he might be terrible on other issues. No.
Outside of the immigration area, Chevron's important.
Oh, I hate Chevron. It's the worst case in the world. Chevron, no one ever talking Chevron, about
Chevron,
it.
Chevron, it's a gas station. Like the gas station.
You don't like the gas station?
No, I hate mobile. one last question here, and then we're going to call it.
What's Chevron? No, don't even go.
No.
Yeah. Come up after and tell you about Chevron.
But, yeah.
Thank you. So, as a doctor, what I hear a lot that bothers me is when people say, why don't immigrants come here legally? What people don't understand is how hard it is to get a U.S. visa. My mom, coming from Brazil, she was 21, and she wanted to come here as a worker. When she realized she couldn't just simply get a worker visa, she doesn't have college education, nothing, she applied for a tourist visa, got that after, who knows, like I think it was 6 months, and then overstayed it because that was her intention. I read somewhere, I don't remember where, but the U.S. visa is the hardest one to get behind countries like Syria, Russia, and North Korea. So I just wanted you to clarify a little bit how hard it really is to come here legally. People don't come here illegally because they want to be here illegally. It's because factors in their country, in their homeland country, pushes them out, mm-hmm, and it's so hard to go through the process because it is broken.
Yeah, the U.S. visa system is very difficult to use. First of all, it costs $175 to actually just apply for a visa. Whether you get it or not, you're paying the money. In many countries, that's a month's salary or 2 months' salary, 2 months' savings that you can put together. Depending on which country you're from, for example, I go to Peru a lot. Peru has a denial rate of about 40% for visitor visas. You go to places like the Philippines where the denial rate is like 80%. Brazil is probably around 40% as well, denial rate. And they don't really tell you why you're denying the visa. When you apply for a visitor visa, for example, you have to prove that you are not going to overstay. So you have to prove a negative. How do you prove a negative? If you've never been there, how do you prove a negative? How do you prove you're not going to overstay? Young women applying for visas from countries like Brazil, it's almost impossible. It's almost impossible to get a visa because they think they're going to go there, overstay, get married, and get a green card. So your chances of getting a visa in many of these countries is virtually nil. We don't have a visa system to get jobs here. Let's say I'm from Brazil, I'd like to come to America and work for a couple of years. We don't have a visa for that. It just doesn't exist. The jobs are here, willing employers are here, but the visa simply doesn't exist. Again, our law is not reflecting the economic realities of our current system.
So please join me in thanking